This is Mad Professor. You're in tune with the dub songs all over the African continent, all over the world. Capital FM taking over the world with dub tuning. Jazz and Jam 100.4 megahertz FM in stereo for people with more than two ears.
Capital Radio. Capital Radio.
Good afternoon, people. Welcome to your Capital Reggae Jam Showcase, which comes on your way every Saturday from 1 o'clock to 3 o'clock from Capital FM 100.4, the sound of a new generation. Or you can catch up via the internet on www.capitalfm.gm. Welcome to another edition. And today is a special edition because today I'm having a legend in the reggae music, in the reggae industry, who is no other than Mr. Denish Bovel. He is here for the Arewa Back to Africa Festival. And I say, Mr. Bovel, good afternoon.
Thank you. Good afternoon. And thank you for your welcome to Gambia.
Yes, Mr. Denish Bovel, can you tell us how it all started for you in reggae music?
Well, when I was at the age of 18 years old, I formed a band, and the name of the band was Matumbi. And we played all over the UK, and we also were the supporting and backing musicians for artists like Pat Kelly, Ken Booth, I Roy, Johnny Clark, you know, in the early days when they came from Jamaica. They came, just the singer would come to London, and then my band Matumbi would be the backing band. And then we went into the studio and recorded some songs with a singer called Louisa Mark. One famous song is a song called Caught You in a Lie, which was her debut single. And also Matumbi was recording for Trojan Records. And then we moved to Safari Records. And then we started to release songs on our own label, the Matumbi label. And then we signed to EMI, where we worked with people like Jacob Miller and Peter Tosh and Bob Marley and people like that. And then I branched out from there to be a sound engineer and a songwriter, composer. I then composed songs like Silly Games for Janet Kay and produced groups like Steel Pulse, also Johnny Clark, my own Matumbi band, and the poet Linton Kwesi Johnson, with whom I've been working for many years now. Also in 1983, I was approached by a singer called Alpha Blondie, and we did the first Alpha Blondie album, Poco di Rock, with songs like Brigadier Sabari and songs like Poco di Rock. And then I work with Alpha Blondie until now. In fact, I just finished the new Alpha Blondie album, which is called Mystic Power, where I'm playing the bass guitar and I'm also the sound engineer. We just mixed that in Alpha's own studio in Abidjan, in his house.
Okay, let me get you back to the early days of the Matumbi, because in 1973, during the Ethiopian Famine Relief concert, you people were the opening band for the Wailers, and you did marvelously until this press said that you people are the best. Can you remind us that concert?
Yes, it was in 1973, and Bob Marley was in London with the Wailers to do the first famine for the Ethiopian, the benefit for the Ethiopian famine. And we were selected to open the show for Bob Marley. And so, with knowing that we were going to perform before a great man, we practiced well, and we did our show. We made our show tight, you know. So when we played, because in those days, groups from London were not respected as much as groups from Jamaica, because people often felt that groups from Jamaica played better sound of reggae than the groups from London. And obviously, because Jamaican groups were the ones who invented reggae, and we were the ones who were learning how to play that. But quickly, we learned how to do it, and so that Jamaican artists were coming to perform with us, you know, from Jamaica. And so it was a highlight of our career then to be on the same stage with Bob Marley, you know. So we practiced well and we played very well, and we got very good press reports about that.
Okay, still with the band Matumbe. In 1976, you did the covered version of Bob Dylan's Man and Me, and that was a huge success internationally. Can you also tell us about that Man and Me covered version of Bob Dylan?
Well, when I first heard the song Man and Me, I didn't know it was a Bob Dylan song. I first heard the song on an album by some Americans by the name of The Persuasions. And they had an album called Street Corner Symphony, where they did a version of this song. And it touched me, and I wanted to do a reggae of this song, and I transformed it to reggae. It's not at all like the Bob Dylan version, but because it was we adapted some of the Bob Dylan lyrics and some of the Bob Dylan melody, we were forced to say it's a Bob Dylan song. But if you compare our version with the Bob Dylan version, you will soon see how we transformed it.
Now let's have a taste of the Man and Me version done by the Matumbes, released in 1976.
Capital Radio.
Man and Me, the sounds of the Matumbes. You tune to Capital Radio 100.4, the sound of a new generation. And this is the Capital Reggae Jam, brought to you by Papa Jamz alongside Ratty.
It takes a woman like your kind to find the man in me. Machine. It takes a woman like you to get through.
Man in Me, specially played for a special woman. Claire, take
okay,
it.
Okay, people, you listening to the legendary Denish Bovel, a UK-based reggae singer and a sound engineer, a producer, presently here in the Gambia. He came for the Arewa Back to Africa festival that my professors used to organize every year. Mr. Denish Bovel, sound systems were an integral part of reggae music. They played a crucial role in the promotion of reggae music. You have a huge sound system, then I called the Jazz of Sound System, and many artists go through your sound system. Can you also tell us about this sound system?
Yeah, well, this sound system was constructed in 1969, and it was constructed so that we could play music for local people, because local people were not able to attend, the dances that cost a lot of money for the entrance. So we played for not a lot of money and to entertain our local people. That's why we called the sound Jasofara Hi-Fi, because the Sofara Hi-Fi was the sound system of the Sofaras, you know. So often we would do free shows, you know, and also to promote my band Matumbi, because Matumbi was recording, and in those days you needed a sound system to play your material so that the public can hear it, because the radio was not very kind to us. Radios didn't play much reggae, they just played few reggae, maybe reggae programs on the radio lasted only 1 hour, and there's millions of reggae performers, so you know the space was small. So in order to take our music to the general public, it was necessary to have the sound systems played. So I was a DJ of a sound system, and so becoming the DJ of a sound system, it made me aware of all the other sound systems, and it's like there's like a brotherhood of sound systems, you know, where all sound system people are like brothers, you know. They share records, they share promotion of artists, and they share appreciation of certain artists, you know. In fact, I have to tell you that before anybody knew who was Burning Spear, the sound systems in Britain made people aware of Burning Spear. Also, before Dennis Brown was usually popular, his music was on the sound systems. Bob Marley too, likewise, Peter Tosh, all of these reggae performers, the sound system is their radio. So the sound systems are played in all over the UK, you know, in the north, the south, the east, the west, and taking the music to the people, you know. So from there we used to make tunes, what we call dub plate, for exclusive songs for the sound system made by the artist, so that the sound system will feel comfortable to play the artist's material and popularize the artist.
Okay, that's the Jazz Sofara sound system. You mentioned here a lady called Lisa Max, may her soul rest in peace. She also rose through that sound system, the Jazz Sofara sound system, which
yes,
is your sound system.
She died in Gambia.
Yes. Okay, can you tell us a little bit about Lisa Max?
Lisa Max was 14 years old. She came to sing on my sound system. She had a wonderful voice. She was invited to be the singer of a song that we were recording, a reggae version of the song's called Caught You in a Lie. The original version was by a man called Robert Parker from America. It was a soul import, and a sound system called Coxon Sound. And the operator of that sound, Lloydie Coxon, was a friend and neighbor of mine. And because we were kind of rival sound systems, we didn't clash in sound clash, but we met in the recording studio where he was paying the studio, you know, to be the producer, and I was displaying my musical talents and Louisa Mark her vocal talents, and we managed to make the first recognizable lovers rock hit in the UK with that song, Caught You in a Lie.
Caught You in a Lie. And also Janet Kay, you mentioned Janet Kay earlier. Janet Kay also, the Silly Games track that you mentioned earlier. This tune also, I think she was the first black woman to hit the UK charts, and it was there for quite a long time. And you produced this Silly Game, and it was a massive hit in 1979, not only in UK, but also in Europe. And Jenny Kay, can you also tell us your relation with Jenny Kay? Because you attempted to fuse the disco and the reggae together, this bottom level strong.
Correct. Around that time, I was working with Fela Kuti and also a guy called Harry Mosco from a group in Nigeria called the Funkies. And we were fusing this kind of Afrobeat rhythm with reggae. And I invented a drum pattern. It was kind of Afrobeat, but you could play reggae with this beat. And then I wrote the song, Silly Games. And I needed a singer who could sing like Minnie Riperton. And Janet Kay fit that description. And so I approached her to say, listen, Janet, will you sing this tune? And also my friend, the drummer from Aswad, Drummy Zeb, who is a magnificent drummer, I invited him to play this pattern that I had invented, you know, which was stemming out of my love of Afrobeat and mix trying to fuse Afrobeat with reggae. And some people call it disco, but I would, by the position of where the snare drum is in that drum pattern, it's more like Afrobeat than disco. And so I constructed this tune with this new drum beat, and then in the course of 3 months, I piled on the instruments on the recording. I first played the bass, and then the keyboards, and the guitar, and the synthesizers, and then I got Janet inside to sing the tune. And we were very fortunate with this production because it rose to the national chart very quickly. Within 3 weeks, it was at the top of the chart. And, you know, worldwide exposure, even as far as Japan, it has been a hit, you know, where at the moment Janet is enjoying much success.
Yes, and it was also recorded in the Genesis Book of Records, Silly Games. Let's have a taste of this tune called Silly Games.
Capital FM 100.4 Capital Radio.